Hello everyone, Christina here. Welcome to another live on Friday here at YouTube. Today is day 11 of the Valentine's Day card series. Can you believe that? We're gonna be doing something really fun today. I thought we haven't done like a really easy DIY Valentine's Day card yet. At least I don't think we have. So we're gonna do that today. We're gonna do a little bit of watercolor. And you may have noticed if you're over Instagram that like I have a special order to all of the things that I do. Like every third post is a mailer envelope and I am due to post a mailer envelope. So we're gonna be doing an envelope today along with the card. So saying hello to everyone in the chat. Hello. I'm so glad you guys are here. I scrolled up a little bit before I started and saw that you were all saying where you're from. I love hearing where you guys are from. Okay, so like I said, we're going to be doing an envelope today, and I've picked out, set that aside there, I've picked out three postage stamps that will be on the envelope that I thought we could base the colors for our card off of. So here are the three little stamps. Stabilize my hand so it can focus in on them. So I have actually all of these would be considered vintage stamps because I don't think any of them are currently being sold. I know this one's not. This one hasn't for quite some time. This one might be, it's a little bit more on the new side. You might be able to find it, that you could buy it from USPS, but I'm not entirely sure. But those are the stamps. So I'm mostly gonna like focus on pinks and purples, maybe a little bit of like a golden orangey yellow, and some red. I really like this purple background. And who can resist Mickey and Minnie, right? So I'm just gonna have these set off to the side while we work on our card. And that's just going to remind me of my color palette. So we're gonna do a little bit of prep work before we get going here. We wanna cut down our watercolor paper and we're gonna cut down the watercolor paper for the envelope as well. We're gonna be making an A2 card today. And I'm using two different kinds of watercolor paper, and it's for a specific reason, and I will show you right here. For the card, we're going to be using some Canson XL watercolor paper. And I think, where did I put my sketchbook? I sketched out this card idea. I think I'll be putting it on a regular card base. So, and I won't be painting all the way to the edge, although maybe I will. That would be kind of cute. Okay. We're going to cut it to be slightly larger than an A2 card. So it's going to be, we're going to make it 5¾ by 4½. So it's just a quarter inch larger in each direction. That's going to give me a little bit of leeway to tape it down so I can paint edge to edge. I can put my scraps back inside my little watercolor pad here. I'll set that aside. And then when it comes to our envelope, I'm gonna be using the 123 punch board from We Are Memory Keepers. I prefer this one over just the envelope one because it has the swing out arm. I don't think we're technically going to need it today because we're making an A2 envelope. But if you're making an envelope any larger than A2, you're gonna want this swing out arm so that you can score all the way. So for today's example, I could use a regular envelope punch board, but I like to do a lot of 5x7 envelopes. So for me, it's worth it to have the 123. So over here on the side, it tells us how big our paper needs to be. Let's zoom in here. If none of you have ever made an envelope using a punch board, this will be a little bit of a tutorial for you. It's super easy. It walks you right through it. In fact, all of the instructions are on the envelope punch board or on the score board, right? So what you're gonna do is you're gonna find your card size in the first column. So down here under A2, it says your paper size needs to be 8¼. And then the punch guide is 3 5/8. So remember those measurements. We'll come back to them and we can always look at it again if we need to. So our paper needs to be 8¼ inch. And that means that it needs to be 8¼ inch square. Now I'm switching to this watercolor paper. Let's zoom out here. That is so zoomed in. I'm switching to this watercolor paper because it's a little bit on the thinner side, but still watercolor paper. So you notice down here it says it's 90 pound and the Canson was 140. If you've ever tried to fold super thick watercolor paper, you probably have noticed and discovered on your own that when you fold it, cracks a lot. It doesn't fold really easily. So I like to use a slightly thinner watercolor paper so that I can get a better fold on my envelope. You do sacrifice some of the like thickness and lushness of the watercolor paper. It's not going to take quite as much water, or can't handle as much water, but it's excellent for envelopes. So I'm gonna peel this out and we're cutting to 8 1/4. Alrighty. And we're gonna have a little bit of watercolor paper left over so we can use the scraps for testing colors. All right. We're gonna go ahead and just make the envelope while we're thinking about it, right? We'll get to the envelope after the card, but we'll make the envelope right now. Okay, so you remember that punch guide number? It is 3 5/8. So I'm gonna swing this arm out just in case I need it. There is a bone folder included in the punch board. It's just conveniently stored there on the side. And what you're gonna do is bring your paper in, and we're concerned about this line here. And it even has like, you know, these vertical lines. It's for the boxes, but it does remind you. And up here at the top, they have it labeled to the 1/8 of an inch. So if any of you are bad with measurements, this board makes it really easy for you. So I'm gonna come to 3 5/8, just lining up this corner with 3 5/8. I'm gonna do two things. I'm gonna punch, and then I'm gonna take this score line down here. It's this bottom one. They have it labeled as envelope score line A. And I'm going to kind of feel for that, see where it's going, and then follow it all the way up to the top. All right, we're gonna be doing that 4 times, one for every side of the watercolor paper. So the way you know where you need to go next is you're gonna take this score line, you guys see that? And you're gonna be lining it up with this groove line right here. It kind of goes right in between these two little nubs. So I like to slide it in and kind of move it around until I feel it kind of lock in place. And that's when I'm gonna do my two things again. I'm gonna punch and I'm gonna score. All right. And then we're gonna follow the same steps again. I'm gonna turn and kind of get that groove in there. Now we're on the opposite side of the envelope, so it should, in theory, line up with 3 5/8, and it does. That's how we know we've made that second score line in the correct spot. Do my two things, I'm gonna punch and I'm gonna score. All right, and then one more time, I'm gonna feel for where that score line goes into the groove. And then punch and score. Okay, so essentially your envelope is ready to be put together. But if you want to add a couple of additional things, like if you want to round the sharp corners, you definitely can. I tend to not worry about that, but if you want a slightly more finished envelope, you definitely could. So here is our envelope. It is ready to go. It's got those score lines. And at this point, I can get rid of my punch board. So I'm gonna put this behind me and we are going to work on our card. All right, so here's my watercolor paper, my Canson XL watercolor paper. I'm going to tape it to a board because we're gonna paint from edge to edge. I wasn't sure if I was going to today, but I think I will. Sandy has a pretty good question. She says, why don't you buy the envelopes? Well, for the most part, when I need an envelope for a card, I do buy an envelope. The times when I don't use a pre-made envelope are when I'm gonna be watercoloring on it, and I will be watercoloring today. So, yeah, there are watercolor envelopes out there. Generally, they're sold with watercolor cards, And the paper that they use for the watercolor envelope is super thin. It's just not even worth it. Like even like the Strathmore card sets, the cards are beautiful. The cards are a great watercolor paper, but the envelopes that they pair with them just leave a lot to be desired. So I have not had good experience with them, and I haven't found an actual envelope made out of real watercolor paper that I love. If any of you guys have suggestions, let me know. Also, Crafting with Slavi has a good answer. She says that she makes a lot of dimensional cards, and so she likes to make envelopes that are a little bit bigger. It's a perfectly good reason. It's a great reason to make your own envelope. If you make oddly sized cards, perfect. All right. I'm gonna take me off the screen. There's Sandy's question. All right. Terry's asking, when do you use the other line on the punch board? I believe it's labeled. Let's see, let's look at it. I think it's labeled for something else. It says envelope score line B. And over here it says for box envelopes also score envelope score line B. So for example, those thicker cards we were talking about, very dimensional, you can make a box card. So basically it's going to give you that much thickness or like a depth for your envelope, so you can put a, you know, very dimensional card in there. Ta-da! Okay. So my plan for today is just painting some very simple hearts. And I'm not even going to create some templates for my hearts. I'm just gonna go ahead and pencil them on. And I want the hearts to be overlapping and then with a little space for a word at the bottom. Hold on, let me grab my sketchbook. I want to see what I have planned. And I put it behind my computer, which is not helping me when I'm live. Okay. So we're basically going to draw five hearts. Hopefully, guys, you'll be able to see this on camera. We're gonna, and they can be kind of wonky hearts. I'm basing them off of these hearts. See how they're kind of chubby, but they're not all the same shape. I want them to look a little bit like that. Maybe I'll put that up there or off to the side so we can see that. Okay, and we can spend as much time as we want sketching these hearts. We don't have to rush on this at all, right? All right, so they do have very pointy points at the bottom, and they're very curved at the top. So they kind of look like that. And you can make your hearts as wonky as you want. All right, I'm gonna have a heart kind of tilted just a little bit, have the point right here. I want it to overlap quite a bit and come down with some hearts. All right, I'm gonna do a smaller heart down here. Actually, I don't like how that one's like directly underneath that first one. So I'm going to erase and restart that one. I'll just have it come over just a little bit. And these are all sort of the same size, which is bugging me. So maybe it would have been good to have some heart templates. Okay. There, that's a little smaller. And it's a little bit off center now too. I'm gonna do a pretty big heart right down here. I'm gonna move that one a little bit. All Yeah, some of you were saying you would have folded some paper and traced the hearts. I thought about doing that, but then I was like, you know what? I'm just gonna try to go a little freehand today. All right, I'm gonna do a much smaller heart right up here. All right. And now I'm going to clean up these lines as much as I can, because I don't want a lot of pencil lines showing on my actual finished card. Okay. Doing a little extra prep work here. It probably definitely would have been easier to cut out some templates. Okay, so I basically have my hearts all figured out. Now I'm going to take my eraser and just lightly go over everything. I just want very faint lines that mostly can fade into the background once I start painting. Okay. I'm going to brush all those off. So now I just have a little inkling of where my hearts are going to be. So let's work on some color mixing now. Move some things out of the way. Can move this over here. As a reminder, here are our stamps. I've got that extra scrap of watercolor paper. And the paints I'm using today, I considered using some Crayolas, but I decided to go with a paint palette that I have not used in a very, very long time. I think I've only used it a couple of times publicly, like on my blog or my YouTube channel. These are some paints from Winsor & Newton and a very inexpensive palette. I rarely use these, and I saw these in my watercolor stash and thought, you know what, why don't I use those more often? So we're gonna mix up some colors. In fact, we might not have to mix too many because these colors are beautiful on their own. Okay, this pink, which is an opera rose directly out of the palette, is the most beautiful pink. Look at that. I think we're going to be using that pink straight from the palette. I do want more of like a orangey pink, so maybe we'll do a little bit of this, add a little pink to it. I did spray my palette first, by the way. That's why the paints are so creamy already. All right. I think that looks pretty good. We need like a golden, like orangey yellow. I'm almost out of this yellow over here. This is Winsor Lemon Yellow, I think it is. I labeled my palette. What is it? It's Winsor Lemon. All right. Looks like I mixed some down here at some point, so I'll just use that same spot. Megan's asking how many sets of watercolor I have. I have not counted. An embarrassingly large amount, that's all I know. Can add a little bit of this orange. Oh, it's probably too much orange. Can add more yellow. All right. It's a nice golden color. I think that works pretty well. And then we've got the purple over here. And this purple is actually a great purple right here. So I don't know that we're gonna need to mix it with anything. Maybe a little bit of pink. But here's the purple straight from the palette. This is the pure color. It's a pretty good purple. So I think I will use that purple, but I'm also going to mix it with a little bit of pink to get another color. All right, got lots of that. Now let's add this upper rose. And we'll get kind of like a red violet. Someone was asking, how do you decide on the colors or the color combos? A lot like I'm doing today, I have a reference, you know, for some colors that I want to match. I do that a lot. Okay. So here we are. Here is our color palette. I think it's a great color palette. We're going to use the same colors for both the card and the envelope. So let's move these over here. And we're going to start with, you know what? I'm not going to do all the way to the edge. I think I'm just going to have these five colors for the five hearts. I'm going to use a slightly larger paintbrush. Let me see if I can grab one. That was a number two, and I will stick with number two. We're going to start with that straight pink shade. We want these fairly transparent so that they, as they overlap, they're going to have a little bit of, you know, like a mix of color. And we're just going to start painting these hearts. And we don't have to have a completely solid heart. We can have some little watercolor sections. We want it to look like we've watercolored it, right? Yeah, just like that. Oh, Andrew says, now the straight purple almost looks blue. Yeah, it's true. Okay, so I don't want any hearts that are overlapping with that one, so I'm going to go ahead and do this one down here. I also want to avoid the yellow overlapping with the purple, right? So I think I'm going to have the yellow up here. I'll have one purple. Okay, yeah, that's what I'm going to do. I'm just planning ahead. Adding a little water to get this color flowing. And I'll just turn this and paint the other half apart. These are going to be very simple hearts today. I'm not doing a ton to them. The real magic is when you start overlapping them. All right, I'm gonna hit this with my heat tool just because all the other hearts are overlapping with the ones I painted. Let's get that yellow, that kind of orangey yellow. And I'm going to try to not go over that pink area too much because I don't want my paintbrush to start to pick up that pink paint underneath. There we go. There's our little orangey color. Hit that with my heat tool. All right, let's do that red that was like a red with a little bit of the pink mixed in. And go right over that pink. So you can kind of see where they overlap a little bit. And this one's going to come down into the purple. It's also going to overlap with a little bit of that orange-yellow shade. Okay. And these are messy hearts, and we like that look, so we're going with it. Okay. Someone just said that they forgot this is an envelope. This is the card that will go in the envelope. We'll get to the envelope here in a minute, but it will have a very similar look to this. We're just going to repeat it on the envelope. Okay, so our last color is the straight purple. So I'm going to get a little bit of this out on my palette because I don't want the purple to be like at full strength. I think that would be a little too much since it's such an intense color. So I'm getting a good puddle going and I'm just adding a lot of water to it. There we go. It's a little more fluid now. And we'll just come in and start painting this other heart. This heart is going to overlap with the red violet heart and the more red heart. Super cute. All right, I'm just gonna let this air dry while we work on our envelope. We're gonna do a very similar effect, but for the envelope, I want to paint the entire like background. So I'm gonna get another board and we're gonna tape the envelope down. Here we are. If you want to do something that's not hearts, you could do the same idea with circles or triangles. I think that would look awesome. All right, I'm just trying to find where that score line is. Monica's asking, which side do you use on your watercolor paper? Generally, watercolor paper has a more textured side and a less textured side. I like to use the textured side. I think it gives it a really fun effect. It looks very watercolor-esque. But when you're stamping images, some people find it a little bit easier to get a good impression of your stamped image when you use the smoother side, which would be considered the back of the watercolor paper. So it's really up to you. It works. They're both going to give you great effects. Okay. I do not want to accidentally paint over these areas, so I'm just putting post-it notes, right? That's what's just sitting here next to me. I was at one point considering using the post-it notes to create those heart templates, so that's why I have post-it notes nearby, but now I'm just using them for protecting my flaps on my envelope, so this will be perfect. Okay. I think I want to have a pale pink background. I'm grabbing a big brush like this, and I'm going to get some of that pink. I do not have any clean spots on my palette. First, I'm going to clean off a spot on my palette. Just cleaning up a spot. I can always remix colors later if I need them. Okay. So, grabbing a bunch of this pink up here. bringing it down to the bottom, and I'm going to water it down quite a bit. I want the background to be pink, but I don't want it to be so overwhelmingly pink that it alters the other colors quite a bit. You know what I'm saying? If the pink underneath is too intense, it will greatly affect the colors on top. Okay, so I'm just gonna start painting this pink background. Now, if you remember correctly, or if you remember from when we started, this watercolor paper is only 90 pounds. It can't handle a ton of water all at once. So you can see how, well, maybe you can't, but it's really bubbled up and warping quite a bit. I'm going to heat set this before I move on. Well, I would anyway, but especially because you can't have this too wet all at the same time. Going to come in with our pencil and start sketching out where the hearts are going to be. First, let's get an idea where our stamps will be. This is a smaller envelope than what I usually use. Usually I do A7 envelope, so I don't have as much space to work with as I normally do. All right, so I think, let's see here. You know, and maybe we will do a little example of drawing the hearts first. And then we can move them around and decide position. I'm not going to do the fold in half thing because I like the more wonky, organic, not perfectly symmetrical look of the first ones from the card. But I will do a little template and cut it out with my scissors. These are some heart shapes. Generally, I like my hearts a little bit more, I don't know, not quite so wonky looking. So this is different for me. All right, let's see, the name will be right here. Take another one of these. I think I'm only going to do three hearts. Let's make this one a little bit smaller. Quite large, but just a little bit smaller. Okay. Here is heart number two. And I think I'll just have that kind of like right there. And then we're going to have a much smaller heart. And we'll put that up near the top. So if any of you out there are not the most perfect heart drawers, this is the idea or the project for you, because you want some really wonky hearts with a lot of personality. All right, and then I think I'll have that one right up there. In fact, maybe we'll slide this down a little. That gives us a little more room for the person's name and then their address. Okay, so I'm just going to start tracing these a little bit. Remember, these don't have to be perfect. Okay. And then I can kind of connect the lines on these. All right, I'm gonna put this one right here so I can get that curve. All right, so we have our three little hearts. Scissors I was using are from EK Success. These are the honeybee scissors. They're non-stick, which is great. All right, just like I did before, I'm gonna very lightly erase some of the pencil lines. Kind of going in all directions. In fact, I can probably remove these now too. All right, and here we go. I think I want, let's see, I'm referencing these colors right here. I basically want these, well, the pink I don't really need. I think I'm gonna do these three colors right here. I love that red, it's so great. All right, let's start with, I'm having to mix a little bit of that yellow orangey shade because I got rid of it, if you guys remember. I needed space on my palette. Okay, mixing some of that up. Okay. And do that orange heart right here. You can pick it up and rotate it. That's why I love working with watercolor that is taped to a board. Okay. This one's going to be purple up here. So I'm gonna go ahead and paint it since it's not touching that yellow one I've already done. Just added water to my brush so I could spread that very intense paint out. Kind of bluebird my heart shape there, but that's okay. There we go. All right, I'm gonna hit this with my heat tool so then I can do the large heart. Large heart is that really pretty red shade. starting to run out of my color. So I'm having to mix them up. It's a little too red now. That's okay. It'll look just a little, have a little bit of color variation, which will actually be nice. Okay. I like seeing those paint strokes in the heart. I think it looks awesome. All right, I want the overlap into the yellow to show up a little bit more. So I'm going to come back in with that yellow shade and just kind of go over the top. I don't know if that really will really do much, but we'll pretend like it does. I don't think I have very much pencil that's not covered by paint, so I don't think I need to clean this up very much. But I do know on the card, there is quite a bit of pencil that I need to erase. Let's see, is this dry? It is dry, okay. All right, you know, I don't know that I'm gonna put a sentiment on this card. I think I'll just leave it up to whatever I write the recipient, because I kind of like just these kind of random hearts. I love it. But I do need to cut it down for my finished card size. Which is awesome, because my tape tore my paper just a tiny bit in that top corner. My paint palette aside, and I can trim this down. We want it to be probably 5 1/4, because I want to have a little bit of a margin. So 5 1/4 by 4. So we can have a little bit of a border around the card. I have a white card base here, and I'm just gonna score it at 5 1/2 to create a top for the card. And then we'll just put that right on top and we'll have a very simple card. I'm gonna put the watercolor panel on some foam adhesive. Okay. As you all know, I am not shy with the foam tape. No saggy middles when you put your card through the mail. Okay. I just saw someone in the comments asking about the eraser that I'm using. It is an Arch foam eraser. I've used it quite a bit. It's Arch foam eraser. I will have it linked down to the supplies after this live is over. After the lives are over, I go back and I add the supplies that I've used. So sometimes I don't know what I'm using yet. So you can get this over at Amazon. I believe Simon's Stamps Simus's stamp carries them as well. Okay, so here's our card. Very simple, all finished. And let's remove the envelope from the board. And we can do the name and address. All right, y'all, I have not picked an address for this envelope yet. So there is a link down below in the video description. Go put your address in. If you want me to consider your name for mail art, I will only look at ones that are coming in within the next 5 minutes. I'll just pick one and we'll go with it. Just make sure you know, I want you to understand your name and address will be shown in this video. And it will also be on my Instagram. So just know for sure. There's a form you fill out. It'll take you a minute. I'll give you some time. I'm going to go ahead and put my stamps on my envelope while you guys go do that. If you've already submitted for this month, submit again, because I'm taking it like within these time constraints right now. So it would be 12:47 p.m. Mountain Time. So you've got to do it right now. And I'm going to go pull it up on my phone. And I can see your submissions as they come in. Alrighty. I'm scrolling down. All right, looks like the first one was Crystal Edwards in Canada. Oh, I don't know if I have enough postage here for Canada. Oh, we might. Yeah, we're good. This can go to Canada. We're totally good. All right, Crystal Edwards. Let me write down. And I think I saw Crystal come say, done, like right away. Okay. Okay. Oh, you've got an interesting address. I like it. Okay, Crystal, make sure that's correct. That's what you have on your spreadsheet. I just want to verify that this is the correct address because I don't know if you guys were watching live, but a few months ago I was doing an envelope and I had the person's house number wrong. I pivoted, I fixed it, but it just happened to be that the woman was watching and we were able to correct it. Okay, Crystal, let me know. Is this the correct address? I verify everything's good. Because I know you were probably like typing real fast. Awesome. It's all good. Let's go here. All right. I believe first class postage to Canada is like $1.10, I think. I might have to stick an extra stamp on here when we're done, but especially because the card has foam tape, it's a little bit thicker. And all of you who submitted but I didn't pick you today, it's all good. I could possibly pick you in the future before this month is out. Who knows? And if you submitted twice because I told you to submit now, don't worry about it. Because I told you to. All right. Press those on really well. So in total, because I think, I'm going to Google this. Current forever stamp value is 55 cents. So that's $1.10. So $1.49. Fairly certain that will be enough to get this envelope all the way to Canada. It might take longer. I mean, post office these days, but you never know. Okay, I'm gonna look it up on my phone. Just so you guys know, you can like calculate a price to ship just from your phone. They have like a rate calculator. So, destination country, Canada. I just wanna make sure. I do this whenever I have an international envelope. Last I checked, I think it was like $1.10. Letter shaped. Oh, here we go. I am. All right, calculating. I'm guessing it's going to be, let's put 2 ounces just to be safe. Letter. Following. $1.20. Look at that. Can you guys see that? $1.20. So I was off. I thought it was $1.10. It's $1.20, but we have like $1.49. So we're totally good. Like even if it needed additional 20 cents because it's non-machinable, which this might be, we're totally covered. Okay, so how do I want to do her address? Let's see here. I think I'll just go get a brush pen. Black, purple, or pink. And have a little scrap of watercolor paper. So let's just test this out. I'm kind of thinking purple. Let's see here. I'm glad I'm testing this out. It's been a while since I lettered. And I'm planning to do her name lettered like this and then very simple for the rest of her address. And that's gonna make sure it actually gets to her. Okay, so that's not the full thing. In fact, I think I want to do more up and down lettering. It's a little bit more casual and goes with the vibe of the envelope. Okay. Purple. I think I'm gonna do black. Yeah, I'm gonna do black. Crystal, I did your daughter's name on a live before too. It's awesome. Yay. Okay. Do I want to draw a line? I think. No. No, I do. I do want to draw a line. I'm going to take out my ruler. And I'm just going to do a faint line right there. And then I've got 1, 2, 3 lines for her address. And then I can erase these pencil lines when I'm done. Okay, here we go. This is when I'm like holding my breath. Let's zoom in here so you guys can see what's going on here better. Okay, here we go. one now. I hope I have enough space. It's going to be tight. Barely made it. You could tell I started squishing things a little bit near the end. It's okay. All right, and then the rest of her address is kind of long on that first line, so I'm gonna have to like do a more condensed capital letters, I think. Okay, yay, it fit. I was concerned. This is another tight one. I have to like think Catherine's is spelled a little differently. I'm so used to having an ER in there. But that's not what she had on her address. Okay. You know what? I'm kind of wanting like polka dots on this heart or something like that. Yeah, like that idea. The real question is, where did I stash my gouache? If you guys aren't aware, I am moving house soon. Moving to a new home and aha, found it. I've started packing. And since I'm mentioning it, this is a good time to bring it up. There will be no live next week because the moving date is getting closer and I things will be in flux. So there will be no live next week. There will be an envelope for the Valentine's Day card series, but it will not be live, just so you guys are aware and can plan ahead. You know, maybe I will have it premiere at the usual time, and then if you guys want to come back at noon, you can watch it together. Definitely do that. Okay, so I'm just gonna add some polka dots, kind of big polka dots, I think. I also had another question for you guys. Last week I mentioned that I'm obsessed with the game Animal Crossing on my Nintendo Switch. And a lot of you, when I went back and looked at all the comments, a lot of you said that you play as well. And I'm wondering if it would be fun to start a Facebook group with crafters who play Animal Crossing. Like, I'm part of one that my friend invited me to that's for sewing crafters, but I'm thinking like card makers would be fun, right? Okay. There have not been any giveaways yet in relation to the moving because I decided going through and like purging was taking too long for the packing. And after I'm at the new house, I'm gonna have like a couple of months, maybe even 3 months, waiting for my craft room to be built. So I'm gonna have plenty of time to go through things. So no giveaways yet, but stay tuned. All right, and now that just makes me want to add polka dots to the card too, right? I think I better. All right, let's add some polka dots over here too. Maybe I'll do this purple and that kind of gold color up there. These are going to be smaller. I can see the chat moving along. I can't look at my computer right this moment, but I'll go back here in a minute because I think you guys have questions about moving and giveaways. So I will look at it just in a moment. Okay, oh, I do love a polka dot. Maybe I'll do stripes on that yellow one just for something different. I like the stripes. Ta-da. I have a couple thicker ones down there, so maybe I'll make it even more random. There we go. I like that. It's more playful. All right, while that dries, I'm going to come back over here and erase the pencil that I use as my guide for the address. I'm going to add my return address, which will only be valid for a little bit longer, so no one send me any mail at this address, please. Because I will be moving mailboxes as well. All right, so now I'm going to take some distress glaze. This is micro distress glaze from Tim Holtz. And I'm going to be adding the distress glaze over areas where there's watercolor. And I think I'll go over my return address as well, just to be thorough. So you just put a little on my little blender brush here, and then just go for it. Every once in a while, I will have something kind of smear with the distress glaze, but it's so minor that I don't worry about it. The one thing you do want to take note of when you use distress microglaze, especially on envelopes, is you don't want to go over your postage, because the distress microglaze puts like a slick coating over the area. That's how it protects the paper from moisture. So the post office can't cancel your stamps if they're all slick. All right, so after you've done that, oh crap, I need a paper towel and I just ran out. Hold on. Thankfully, I have not packed my storage closets yet, where I store all the extra paper towels. So you take a paper towel and you buff off the extra. This is where sometimes you get a little color. See, there's a little bit of pink on there. You might get just a little bit of color from your artwork underneath. But you just buff off the excess and then let it dry. And at first, you're going to have a little bit of a film, like you can feel it on your fingertips. But it eventually goes away completely. All right, and to put the envelope together, I use like score tape or express tape, and when you fold in the flaps, this is something you take note of. When you fold up the flaps and then you fold up the top, the bottom, notice how there's a gap right there. You don't want any adhesive on the flap right there. So some people just put adhesive on the sides, but I don't know, maybe I like living on the edge a little bit. I'm gonna put it on the bottom flap and just not quite all the way to the corner. And then one more thing to note when you make your own envelopes, and I didn't know this until I was doing a lot of mail call, like opening envelopes. And every once in a while I'd get a handmade envelope that the person had glued all the way to every corner. And that, it was so hard to open the envelope. A lot of them, I had to like cut the edge off, and you run the risk cutting the card inside. So I'll show you here in a minute what I do when I close one of these envelopes. First of all, I use my bone folder to make the flaps fold down really nice. I fold that up. Okay, so when I go to close this envelope, right? Let's say I've got the card in, I'm ready to mail it. I'm not going to put adhesive all the way to the corners. I'm going to stop about right here so that these corners right here have enough lift that the person can get like their envelope opener underneath. So yeah, just be aware of that. All right, so here we go. Card and envelope for today. Love how that turned out. Crystal, forgive me if you don't get your envelope for a very long time. All right, let's go to our usual split screen. Let's see, how can I, we're gonna zoom out here so you can see the project. There we go, that works. Ta-da. Okay, so we're finishing up around our usual time, around, you know, about an hour later, maybe a little off from that. But all right, I'm going to scroll up and see if there were any questions that came through. Someone was wondering about the brush pen that I used. This is a Pentel brush sign pen. It's actually written on this one. It's a brush sign pen. Come on, camera. There we go. Brush sign pen from Pentel. Let's see here. Do you have to wash the glaze off of the sponge? That's this one we should talk about. If you notice, this sponge is pretty gross looking. No, I just have a dedicated sponge for my distress glaze, and I just store it right on top, like sitting there, so I know that's the one that goes with it. Beth's asking my age. I am 38. Did I keep my maiden name for crafting business? Yes. What size paint brushes are you using today? The one that I did the hearts with is a size 2 round. When I did the large background in the pink, that was a 3/4 inch flat brush. Okay. I'm so confused. Someone was saying these three stamps together are $1.65. It's not, because these two are $55, so that's $1.10 plus $39, so that would be $1.49. I didn't major in math. Is that right? Anyway, I only need $1.20 to get to Canada, this envelope, so we're definitely safe. Nalita, maybe that's how you say your name. I just purchased the Dr. Peach Martin's Bleedproof White. I was wondering if you've used it and would prefer it to the white gouache. I have used it. I have some. I do like it. I find that the gouache is a little bit easier to work with because it's in a squeezy tube. The Bleedproof White is very thick, and you do have to water it down to a good consistency, but it's in a jar and it tends to dry out really quickly, but I do like it. The Bulletproof White is permanent once it's dry, so that's, it's really great for envelopes. But I always just go straight to gouache because it's a little bit easier to work with, and I know I will be sealing it with microglaze anyway. So it really just depends on, you know, what your preference is. Okay. I would have to take over the dining room if I had to wait 3 months for a craft room. Well, I might be taking over the table. I don't know. It depends. I've got to figure out my lighting and all that. So we'll see how it goes. Someone says they would love a crafty Facebook group for Animal Crossing. Yes. Look for that. I might start it. I don't know. Let's see here. 3 months with no craft room? That's what Andrea says. Yeah. Especially with COVID and just the pandemic and things like that, like getting subcontractors to come in and getting supplies and cabinets and countertops, everything's just slower in general. So, okay. Oh, that's a good point, Crystal points out. The polka dot heart reminds me of Minnie. That's a really good point. Even though Minnie doesn't have polka dots on this stamp, she usually does have polka dots. So that's very true. Oh my word, Jessica, I just got Animal Crossing because you mentioned it. I'd be up for a Facebook group. That means you're brand new. Okay, so we're gonna have to be friends, and I will come to your island and I will bring you island warming gifts, because my friend Jen did that for me and it was so lovely and it helped like jumpstart the game for me. So yes, we're starting a group. I've just decided. Let's see. Oh yeah, here we go. Kathy, that sounds like fun. That would be a great reason to have my husband buy me a Switch. I want it for Pokemon too. Yes, excellent reason to buy a Switch. That's the only game I have. That's the only, okay, so my now husband, who is my fiance at the time, gave me the Switch for Christmas. I was dropping, I thought like back in April, May, I'm like, maybe if I mention that I want a Switch and I want to play Animal Crossing, maybe, you know, but it wasn't like a full campaign, like I really want a Switch. But every once in a while I'd be like, oh, I really want to play Animal Crossing, because I would see people online mention it. And then I just mention out loud, I really want to play Animal Crossing. So the story goes, we decided, you know, since we were buying a house, we were going to limit how many gifts we got each other and me, even had a money limit on it. You're thinking, what was your money limit if you bought you a Switch? Well, there's a story. So there's two gifts. Well, three. I've opened one gift. I'm opening the second. And he gave me an order of how I was to open the gifts. So I opened the second one and I open up the box and it's the actual Animal Crossing game itself. And I'm like, oh, is there a Switch or whatever? And he goes, well, I thought you could use my Switch to play. I'm like, oh, okay, totally. I'm good with this because I just want to play in general. I can borrow your Switch and play. So I was all pumped. And then I opened the third gift and it is the actual Switch console. And I got freaked out. And then I was like, wait a minute, we had a dollar limit on our gifts this year. And he said, yeah, I sold a bunch of my games at GameStop to make up the cost difference. And I was like, of course you did. He's so logical like that. I love it. Love him. So anyway, I got a Switch. And I've only played Animal Crossing on it. I downloaded a few of the free games. Like when you sign up for Nintendo Online, they have some games you can download. And one's like Super Mario something, or I think it's Mario Kart. I'm not sure what it is. And there's Tetris, things like that. I think I opened Tetris once and then I was like, I want to play Animal Crossing. And then I went back to Animal Crossing and I played it ever since. Highly recommend this game. It is so dang cute. It's just durable. And it got super popular right when lockdowns went down, like were happening last spring, because it came out at the exact same time. And the whole idea behind it is that you have moved to an island that you share with just a few other villagers, and you have to cultivate the land and like build a house. And, you know, like it's fun. It's like creating your own island and you have villagers that have personalities. It's adorable. Highly recommend. Okay, I'm sure comments are coming in. I'm missing them here totally. Let's see here. Are you planning spring watercolor classes? I don't have one specifically planned. Jennifer and I are planning for a class in March. We've got to get like really going on it soon, but I'm in the middle of moving, so we might have to push it back a little bit. But We do have a class planned for March, but it is not watercolor. Stay tuned. Let's see. Andrea's asking, were the watercolor Winsor & Newton professional or Kottmann? They were the professional ones, the artist grade. The professional watercolors, yeah. Let's see here. Kathy likes that there's no sentiment on the card. Love that. I love it too. Monica's asking, do you ever use the watercolor tubes? That's a lot of what I use. In fact, the paints I used today were tube watercolors that I had put into a palette so that I could paint them more easily. Tube watercolors, I generally don't use them straight out of the tube. I always put them in a palette, let them dry and set up, and then I reactivate them with water. I find that I don't use as much paint that way, and I don't waste any paint. Not that you have to waste it. I mean, you could, like, you know, after you've painted straight from the tube, you could let it dry and then essentially do what I do and reactivate it with water. But I don't tend to paint directly from the tube. Okay. Let's see here. I'm trying to find any other questions that I can answer quickly. I think I've gotten back to where I was. Let me scroll down to the bottom for any new ones. Happy Stamp is asking, do you have to have a Switch? I have an old DS. Yes, I believe it is only a Switch game. You can, okay, I recently learned all about this. There's the Nintendo Switch console, and then there's the Nintendo Switch Lite. The reason it's called a Switch is because it has the screen, and then it has the controllers on the side. You can remove the controllers, dock the screen and hook it up to your TV, and then just use the controllers separately and play looking at your TV screen. So you can have it large and have the sound through your TV. Or you can like put it back together and it's like a handheld video game console. So that's what the whole Switch name comes from, I believe. This is me drawing my own conclusions. They came out with Switch Lite, which is a smaller version. The screen's a little smaller and you cannot remove the controllers. You cannot hook it up to your TV. So it is just the portable gaming console, like the personal gaming console. You can play all Switch games on both of them, I believe. You can play Animal Crossing on the Switch Lite or on the original Switch. If I were you, I would recommend getting the original Switch, mostly because you can also play on your TV and there's a little more flexibility there. And there's an Animal Crossing edition. That's the one that I got. That's real cute. It's got blue and green controllers on each side. So anyway, I am not the biggest like gaming person in the world, but I can do some Animal Crossing. And it's fun because my sister and my nephew's girlfriend, she's like family because they've been together a long time. And then now my sister-in-law and my other niece want one, but you can get online and you can visit each other's islands and, you know, play games and go fishing and swimming together. So I don't know. It's fun. Like my sister and I, we put each other on speakerphone on our cell phone so we can hear each other talking and then we play the game together. It's really fun. So anyway, enough about Animal Crossing. You guys aren't here for Animal Crossing. You were here for some card making. So thanks for indulging me. Watch for that Animal Crossing Facebook group announcement. I will definitely let you guys know. So anyway, thanks for joining me today. I will be back on Monday with the day 12. Is it 12? No. Yes, 12 video. Day 12. Wow, that's crazy. I'll be back on Monday with that. And then I'll have a video on Wednesday for 13. And we'll finish this series on Friday for day 14. Once again, I will not be live next Friday. We're going to be in the middle of getting ready for the move and like, it's just going to be crazy. So you might not see me for a little bit after that. I'm going to try to keep to a schedule, but it's a lot. So anyway, oh, did Kathy Z just get in here? Hey, Kathy. Love her. All right, I will see you guys very soon. Until I'm live again, have fun. And thank you guys so much for watching. I enjoy communicating with all of you guys every week. Thanks for watching. I'll see you guys next time.